that we worship him, that we praise him for who he is tonight. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. If you were here Sunday and the Lord did a miracle or healed you or did something for you, would you raise your hand? Okay, now of those of you that have your hands up, I just need three of you that, now listen to the instructions because instructions are important. I need three of you that have the ability to give a testimony in under 60 seconds. Okay, if you would make your way forward quickly. You can be seated while those three are coming. Since so many are coming, we're going to have to take numbers. Are you coming or are you? Oh, he's not coming. All right, then I need someone else. He was walking kind of quick like he was going to take the mic. Of those three that, not everybody at the same time. All right, I'll lower the number to two. If not, I'm going to have to start telling jokes. Thank you all the way in the back. Brother Glenn, I gave you a shout out and you left me hanging. Okay. There's one, two, I need one more. Since we said he's the God of a threefold covenant, I need one more to make his way up. Brother Glenn, 60 seconds or less.
Good evening, church. I'm sorry, Brother Suarez, I ran off the other day and didn't get a chance to give you some love. But I just want to let the church know that Brother Suarez spoke about a miracle that happened to me. A lot of you here at the church are aware of this. Those of you who aren't, you know that there came a day where I didn't wake up one morning, my heart decided to stop working, and they had pronounced me dead not only once, but they brought me back three times. And in doing that, I prayed that while I was laying down, that, Lord, if you just give me a chance to stand up, just give me a chance to get up off out of this bed, I can't wait to worship you and let you know the greatness of God. So when you see me up here jumping around, and when you see me up here worshiping, I'm just here to let you know how grateful I am that we serve a miracle God and that I cannot stop worshiping and representing the King of Kings.
All right, now don't leave. Just stay here.
Good evening, church. You probably, most of you know that a few years ago I had three brain aneurysms that bled out. And the doctor said that I wouldn't live, and I did. And then he told my family that I'd be severely brain damaged, and I'm not. And a week ago, they found another brain aneurysm in the worst place you can have one. And we don't quite know what they're going to do yet with me, but God knows. And I've been feeling a lot of peace over all of it.
Amen. Yes. Don't leave.
I'm going to stand here on behalf of Brother Guzman. I want to say after 38 years of suffering with pain, after God knows how many, seven surgeries, no hips, walking with one hip, walking with no hips, and the doctor saying he's not going to live, and I don't know how many times they told this that he wasn't going to make it to the next day, and who knew that God was, you know, those feet were going to have to come off, but you know what? 38 years of fasting and praying and waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting. It is here. It has been so good to see him come into our services, and he's been so excited. He's so full of joy and peace. There's peace in the house, in my house, finally, because he gets to sleep at night. And I just want to say, you know what? If you are waiting on a miracle, wait. Just wait, because he is faithful, and he will come through.
Who is that man? Is he here? He's not here tonight. He waited 38 years? Just like the man at the pool of Bethesda. If you've made it 38 years, there's a miracle on the way. Anybody wait 38 years, there's a miracle on the way. Now, on Sunday, the Lord, and it's not normal, common, whatever, that I don't normally call out names, but the Lord gave a name, and we called out Neil. And Neil was in the service. Now, he made us sweat. He made us wait like 3 minutes for him to reveal that he was here, but he was here. And after I prayed for Neil, I was walking back, and I heard the Lord say another name in my mind, but I didn't say it out loud because it's a preacher, and I knew he wasn't in the service. I don't never met the man. I just know the name. And so I was driving with Brother Wiley to the airport. I flew to Dallas after Sunday service. We were driving, and he said, you know, when Neil didn't, when Neil didn't reveal himself. He said, you said that it might be a son. He goes, you know, I got a son-in-law named Neil. I said, oh, okay. Yeah, I was tired. I mean, we're just making random conversation at that point, you know. And I said, oh, okay, yeah, that's cool. I said, you know, Brother Wiley, you know, the deal is I really heard the Lord say, Neil Heiler. I'm supposed to pray for Neil Heiler. He said, that's my son-in-law. Now, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, for those of you that are unsure if this is real or not, we can't make this kind of stuff up. This isn't, now let me sit down for a minute and tell you something. Only in an apostolic church, only in a Pentecostal church, will a man get up and say he died and had to be resurrected three times. Only in an apostolic church will you hear something like that and people say, wonderful. Only in apostolic church will you hear that someone having brain aneurysms and supposed to have brain damage, and we just say, praise the Lord. If it was anywhere else, CNN, Univision, Telemundo, Fox, Drudge, and all the rest would be out there interviewing. People would be standing in awe. But I preach Sunday. He is the God of the miraculous. And we're so used to God doing the miraculous for us around here that it just doesn't shock us when we hear that someone didn't wake up but God raised them back to life. It's not uncommon for us to hear that they were supposed to have a brain damage but the Lord changed it. It's not uncommon for us to hear that someone waited 38 years but they received the miracle, because he is the God of the miraculous. Now, with that said, as commonplace as I want the miraculous to be, I want God to know that we're grateful for today for everything he's done. So would you give God a shout of praise, and would you make him glorified in this house? Hallelujah. If you never understood why we run and why we jump and why we clap and why we go crazy and why we fall out and why we talk in tongues, it's because we serve a God that when you don't wake up, he'll wake you up. When the doctor says it's over, he'll say it's not over. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. Remain standing. Hallelujah. We might preach. I don't know exactly what we're doing. I'm trying to kill time and figure out what to do exactly tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, I've seen them fake that stuff on TV. You know, I watch 2020. I watch prime time. Well, there can't be a counterfeit without there being something real first. They were faking what we do for real in this house. And if you're not convinced by three, and you need more, if he's ever done a miracle for you at any point in your life, would you raise one hand? Now, if he's done more than one miracle for you, would you raise two hands? Well, it looks like the majority agrees that he is the God of the miraculous. Hallelujah! I heard Sister Heidi say right now, he's a right now miracle working God for whoever will praise him and exalt him in this house. I believe that what happens in this house tonight can affect the United States of America. I believe we have enough influence with God that we could change the course of our country by coming before the Lord in prayer and in worship. I believe an angelic army could be loosed upon this country and bring revival to this land. I feel authority in the Spirit tonight to prophesy, to worship the name of the Lord, and to see miracles take place. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Sister Heidi needs the microphone.
Oh, hallelujah. I came to you 2 weeks ago on Sunday, and I declared God's goodness. And what did I say? God gave me a house with no money down. He blessed. And I was ever thankful. On Sunday, I don't know if you guys caught what the man of God said, but he challenged the congregation to 40 days of prayer for the outrageous, the miraculous. I took that serious. All day long, after church, it was in my heart. I went home. I made a list for the outrageous. I made a list for the miraculous. I made a list for the supernatural. I made a list for the financial. I made a list for my business. I prayed over it. Monday morning, phone call rings. I was talking to someone else. They say, you got to take this phone call. A man from Morgan Hill, where I live, my business is 30 miles south in Hollister. He's on the phone. 45 minutes later, he's in my office, and he wants me to buy him out. Okay? Next thing I know, yesterday, somebody offered him far more money, $25,000 cash down, and our deal was off. Before I came into this church tonight, I have the signed contract in my car, zero money down, $4,000 a month income, and I'm going to pay him 15% on that. And I have an office as of tonight in Morgan Hill, half a mile from my office, from my house.
Well, you think that's an accident? You think that's coincidence? This is the favor of God. You can be seated.
9 years ago, the Lord sent me to Norfolk, Virginia. I didn't want to go. I didn't want anything to do with it. I wanted to move to California. I had a dream one morning, and I 12 years ago had a dream. I wasn't married yet, and I was in this dream with this faceless bride. You talk about being scared. Faceless bride. I'm like, oh, Lord, let her have a head when she marries me, Lord Jesus. And in the dream, I marry this faceless bride, and I'm trying to go west, and there's all these arrows saying, go east, go east, go east. And a few years later, I get married, and I marry a girl from Virginia, from the East Coast, and I tried to move to California. And I told her when we got married, I said, you have to understand, I will never live in the state of Virginia. I don't like it. I don't like the people. Don't get offended. Well, you won't get offended. You're not from there. I don't like the people. I don't like biscuits and gravy can only go so far. I need ribs. I need pizza. I'm from Chicago. I need Italian food, and it not Pizza Hut. I mean, that beefaroni's not going to make it. And I said, you have to understand, I will never live in the city of Norfolk, Virginia. Okay. We got married 15 months later. We're in a moving truck on our way to Norfolk, Virginia, and she's laughing. We moved there. I had no clue what we were doing. I thought I was waiting to go back to Chicago. The Lord planted us there. We begin a church. God begins to grow the church. And from 4 to 5 to 50 to 60 to 100, 150, 200, all the way up to 250 people baptized in 3.5 years. And 67% undocumented immigrants. We didn't fit in. And we're renting a building. And we need. And one day, I just felt to buy a building. We're going to buy a building. Now, we have no credit. We have no money in the bank, and over half of the church is undocumented. I don't care how you feel about it. It's just the reality. God did not call me to check green cards. He just made me to make sure that they're legal in heaven. That's all I'm supposed to do. So I find out about a building, 28,000 square feet, 3 acres, and I said, let me check that one out. And I went one night to pray with my assistant pastor, and I told him I'm going to lay hands on the building and pray. You can say I'm weird, but I am absolutely weird without any apology of it. And I went to pray on the building. I laid hands, and the Lord said, why do you ask me for what is already yours? 30-second prayer, got in the car, and the assistant said, I thought you said you're going to pray. I said, I did. And the Lord said, why am I asking him for what's already ours? And he said, are you sure? I said, yes, sir. We went home. I called my mentor slash pastor slash advisor slash financial guru who flew out from California to Virginia, and we went to negotiate, and the owner of the building said, how much money do you have to put down? I said, we have no money. He said, have you gotten a pre-approval letter from the bank? I said, we have no credit. We can't get a loan from the bank. He said, well, then how are you going to get a loan? I said, well, we need you to finance it if you would be willing to do that. He said, well, you want me to do what? I'm trying to sell the building. He said, do you know how much it's worth? I said, yeah, the city assesses it for $2.3 million. He said, and you have that? I said, no, we don't have that. But we could probably do like $600,000-ish, maybe, you know. And he laughed in our face. He said, how dare you come in here and insult us? Laughed in my face all the way out. And that elder, advisor, spiritual, financial, all that stuff, guru, that's Pastor John Shivers from Stockton. And we got laughed out of the building. And Brother Shivers is cool the whole time. I'm upset. I have a temper. And, you know, I never show it, of course. My wife has never seen me lose my temper. But I lost it that day. And I was mad. And I was talking in tongues. And maybe not some spiritual tongues. But I was upset. And Brother Shivers got in the car and he said, well, that was interesting. I said, yeah. He said, why don't you? He said, you know what? It's still early. Let's go to Ruth Chris. I said, Ruth Chris. I said, you want steak at a time like this? He said, I sure do, and you're going to pay for it. I said, whoa. Man, I can't even buy a building. You want me to buy steak? And the whole way there, I'm complaining, and I'm arguing. And he stopped. He said, now, wait a second, faith preacher. Didn't you say you had a word from the Lord? And I said, yeah. He said, then what are you worried about? He said, don't mess up my dinner tonight. He said, we're going to go to Ruth Chris. We're going to get a good steak, and I don't want you to complain. I don't want to hear about it. You said you have a word from the Lord, so why don't you just believe it, faith preacher? Man, I mean, those are fighting words. If you've been in church, those are fighting words. And so we went and we got it. And he said, while we're eating, he just, you know, he's kind of quiet. Well, I don't really have much to say at this point. And he's chewing on his ribeye, and he says, you know, Tony, do you realize that if God really wants you to have that building and you really have a word from the Lord, you realize that if someone else offers more money, they could go to the closing table, try to sign the papers, and the pen could run out of ink if it really is supposed to be yours. I said, now you're weird. I thought I was weird. That's weird. 3 months go by. I get a call. Yeah, we have somebody else who's interested in the building, and they've offered three times more money than what you ever offered, and they have cash. And cash is king. Anybody ever worked in sales knows that cash is king. Now, I mean, I have felt like I missed it. I blew it. I never heard the Lord. And then about 6 weeks go by, and the owner of the building called, and he said, Reverend Suarez, do you still want to buy this building? I said, well, I don't have that kind of money. You know our situation. He said, it turns out that we were 3 weeks from closing, and those people lost their money. Now, I'm not feeling, you know, I'm not making fun. I'm not glorifying in anything like that. But he said, you know what? We can't find another buyer. We're too far into it. He said, our board has decided that whatever terms you want, we're going to agree to, as long as you want to buy the building. He said, so what are your terms? I said, I don't know what my terms are. He said, well, you better figure them out and call me back. Within a few days, we bought a $2.3 million building for $600,000. Listen to this. He never looked at a checking account statement. He never checked our church credit, which we had none. He bought it on a handshake. He said, because I believe that the Lord wants you to have the building. They owner financed it for us. And that's when it got a little touchy, because Brother Shivers said, now, Tony, the bank, the best rate you could get is maybe 6%. So you got to be ready that they're going to probably charge you more than that because it's owner financing. So I called the owner and I said, you know, I didn't think the thing all the way through. And he said, well, how do you know what we're going to charge you in owner financing? I said, I don't know. I just assumed. And he wasn't as, you know, as sanctified as I am. And he said, well, have you ever heard about what happens to people that assume? And I said, yeah, I've heard. He said, well, that's what's happening to you. He said, how does 1.5% sound? I said, 1.5% what? He said, what about 1.5%? And he goes, you know what? Commercial deals are usually 20 years, but how about we go 1.5% over 30 years, and let's not do a traditional 20% down. He goes, whatever you got, maybe 5%. If you could come up with 5% in maybe 6 months, we'll go ahead. And he said, and you know what? We're just so sure you all are going to do it. If you'll swing by Sunday, we've decided we're going to just go ahead and give you all the keys, and we'll close in 6 months, but you go ahead and you just take the building because it's your building. The day I signed the contract, our church only had, and this is the before the Lord, we had $367 in our church general fund. We're not one of those churches has, you know, accounts. We had an account. And in the account, we had $367. And the day we had $367, we signed the contract on a $600,000 building that's 3 acres, 28,000 square feet with a school building. And if that wasn't enough, when God told, you know what my mortgage payment, well, I don't pastor the church anymore, but you know what our mortgage payment is? Silicon Valley, don't get upset. 28,000 square feet. Our mortgage payment, $1,900. Now, if that wasn't enough, now hold on, because when God gives you something, this is the God of the miraculous. When God gives you something, if he blesses you, he will also provide the resources to bless you to pay for the thing he's given you. So after he gave us the building, a month later, a pastor calls me and he says, I'm the pastor of the church that tried to buy the building when our finances fell out. He said, it's the weirdest thing. We lost all our money and we couldn't come through on the purchase of the building. But now all the money that we lost that was tied up, it just came back to us. And we're wondering if we could rent the building from you all. You know how much I charge them? $1,900. Not only did he give me a building, he gave me somebody to pay the building because he is the God of the miraculous. He is the God of the miraculous. Now, I left that church last summer. I'm moving to Washington, D.C. We're starting another church in Washington, D.C. Someone said, you're crazy. You're going into the heart of D.C. Yes, I am, because there are donkeys and there are elephants in D.C. that are constantly fighting, and the donkeys are very stubborn, and the elephants don't have a lot of courage, but behold, the Lamb of God. So we're going to take the Lamb of God into the middle of Washington, D.C. We're going to start another church, and real estate is expensive in the middle of Washington, D.C., but I have a point of reference in my mind. I have a testimony of what he did in Norfolk, Virginia. And I've told the Lord, if you did it in Norfolk, Virginia, you're going to do it again in Washington, D.C. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Every time the Lord gives you a miracle, you're not supposed to take it and throw it away and just put a Facebook post. It's a point of reference in your mind so that the next time you need something of the Lord, you can look back and say, I've been truly blessed. Like the song says, I have a testimony. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Israel lost everything that they had one day on a battlefield. They lost the Ark of the Covenant. They lost their promise. They lost their priest. The priest lost his children. They lost everything. And they lived in despair for 20 years. But they had a promise over their life that they were the apple of God's eye, that they were the chosen people of the Lord. They had a promise over their life, even though their current situation did not match their promise. They had a promise and a word over their life from a covenant God who is the God of yesterday, today, and forever. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He is the God of yesterday, today, and forevermore. They lived 20 years in despair without what belonged to them. They just lost it all. They're in a state of depression. All hell is broken loose in their life. 34,000, 38,000 people died on that battlefield. They lost their fathers, their brothers, their sons, their cousins, their uncles. I mean, if they have a right to be depressed, if anybody has a right to be depressed, it is them. However, they have a promise of the Lord over their life. And after 20 years of living without the ark, after 20 years of losing everything that was precious to them, one day a prophet got up by the name of Samuel and he said, I'm taking you back to the battlefield, and this time we're not going with swords and with shields and with spears. This time we're going to go with a sacrifice. We're going to build an altar and we're going to worship the Lord. And they said, you got to be crazy. You want to take us back to that place where we lost it all? You want to take us back to that moment of depression, that thing that I've been trying to forget for 20 years, that thing that I've had to go talk to doctors about, that thing that I've been trying to, you want to take me back to that place, and you want me to worship God here? You want me to worship him with the memory of all the things that have happened to me and the defeat and the loss and the struggle? You want me to worship God here? And Samuel said, yeah, I want you to worship God. I know you can worship him over there, and I know you can worship him over there, and I know you can worship him on the mountaintop, and I know you can worship him in the victory field, but I want to know if you can worship him here, because if you can worship him here, you can worship him anywhere. See, a true worshiper, hallelujah, a true worshiper
Hallelujah. A true worshiper is not governed by circumstance. A true worshiper is not governed by what happened around them. There is real pain. There are real emotions. But a true worshiper has the ability to go into a battlefield where they lost it all. And even though they lost it all, they say, yet will I praise thee, because you are the God of yesterday, today, and forevermore. I'm prophesying to somebody today, even if your yesterday was messed up, you are to praise God, because he's still the God of today and forevermore. I don't know what happened yesterday, but today is a day of blessing, and tomorrow is a day of blessing. He said, I want you to praise God here. They said, here, yeah, here, right here, with the memory of your sickness, with the memory of your bankruptcy, with the memory of what happened in your family, with the memory of the friends that deserted you, with the memory of everything that went wrong, right here, where everybody says you're supposed to lose your mind, where everybody says you're supposed to give up, where everybody says you're supposed to kill yourself, right there, I want you to praise the Lord. I want you to sacrifice to him and lift him up and show the enemy that the God that you serve is bigger than anything that the enemy could throw against you. The best praise does not take place on mountaintops. The best praise takes place in valleys. The best praise takes place when the circumstance around you doesn't warrant it, but the God that you serve warrants the praise. It's at that time when you are truly tested that you show if you really believe what you say you believe. It is at that moment when you show how much you actually reverence and glorify and respect the name of the Lord God. Because it's in those moments when you're supposed to give up that it drives the devil insane. And I don't like to glorify him. But what? They're going to praise him now? On the side of a street with their car flipped over? Now they say, thank you, Jesus? Tow truck on the way to repo the car, and they said, well, thank the Lord, we still have food on the table. Right now, I got their kids messed up in drugs and lost in gangs, and they're still saying, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you and your house shall be saved. It bothers him. It messes with his mind that you have the ability to worship and glorify the name of God and lift him up and high despite your circumstances. But see, what us true worshipers know is that regardless of what's going on around us, there's one thing that stays the same. He that sits on the throne is high and lifted up, and he changes not. He changes not. He is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He is the God that set the slaves free in Egypt. He is the God that made a way for Daniel in the lion's den. He is the God that delivered David from Goliath. And he is the God that's going to give me the victory. And they worshiped God in that spot. And when they did it, a phenomenon occurred. Actually not, well, you know, I said that because it sounded cool. But actually something very common occurred. When they finally got everything right, you know who came back? Their enemy. Isn't it amazing? Isn't it incredible that when you try to get everything back in order, that old temptation comes back. That ex-boyfriend or girlfriend or wife or husband comes back. Isn't it amazing how an old partner that bankrupt your first company comes back when you get the second one on its feet? It's amazing how our enemies have a knack at finding us when we really want to forget about them. It's amazing how you try to get your life right with God and all this old stuff starts coming back. And that's what happened. You know, you guys said you're going to move the oil for me, and it's still there. You have a lot of faith in me, I guess. It's amazing. Oh, yeah, you don't have that much faith in me, though. Amen. He said, but I have faith in the Lord. He said, I heard that. That's all right. It's amazing that they're in the valley worshiping the Lord. And the Bible says that the mountains filled with the Philistines. I have asked the Lord, why is it that when it seems like everything is going the right way, it's when my critics always come back?
those that have hurt me and those that call themselves my enemy. Why is it that, why can't they leave? I mean, I just got my, you know, I get everything straightened out, and that's when the attack wants to come back? They're just getting everything ready when the Philistines come back. And I heard the Lord say, it's not the devil. See, I used to think, well, it's the devil. That devil. It's because the devil wants to bring me down. The devil. The Lord said, it's not the devil. It's me. I said, you're the one, my father, the one that loves me, the one that's supposed to want the best for me. You brought my enemies back? He says, yes. I said, well, I'm going to need some Bible for that, because they're never going to believe me when I preach that one. He said, remind them what it says in the book of Psalms chapter 23. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. He said the reason that your enemies, your critics, and all the things that have come against you, the reason that they've come back is not for your defeat and it's not for your despair. I've brought them back because they saw you when you were cursed. They saw you when you were lost. But now I want them to see you blessed. I want them to see you with the favor of God. He said, I brought them back because I'm about to prepare a table of blessing for you in the presence of your enemies, to the point where even your enemies are going to have to confess, this man, this woman has the favor of God over their life. If anybody has some old people trying to stir back up inside of your life, don't rebuke them. Get ready to party, because God's about to prepare a table for you in the presence of your enemies. Oh, yeah. You know, we do a lot of rebuking of the devil. Get behind me, Satan. Get out. I said, devil, come to church tonight. Come to church. Oh, don't bring him into church. I'm scared. The devil. Yeah, well, see, here's the deal with this guy. This guy saw us when we were lost, when we were backslidden. He was with us when we were defeated, and he celebrated. And the day you tried to get things right and he saw that he couldn't knock you down, he tried to go out the back door and slip out the back. I said, no, devil, you saw me at my worst. Now I want you to see me at my best. I want you to see me worshiping and praising the Lord. I want you to see that no weapon formed against me can prosper. I want you to see that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And I want you to see that I'm just like those Israelites, that in the place where I lost it all, I can give God praise. The Bible says that they praised the Lord until there was a voice that thundered from the heavens. There was a shout that came from the heavens. They didn't have to fight the battle because the Lord fought the battle for them. And in just a moment, after 20 years of not having their promise, in just a moment, they got the Ark of the Covenant back. They got their promise back. They got their cities back. They got their land back. And the enemy had to flee just because they were willing to praise God where they lost it all. I don't know who I'm preaching to tonight on this beautiful Wednesday night, but if you would praise God in your battlefield, I prophesy to you, your promise will come back. Your businesses, your city, your money, your family, it'll come back, and the enemy will flee. And it was right there that the prophet said, bring me a stone. We're going to erect a large monument here unto the Lord. And we're going to call it Ebenezer, which means the Lord is our stone of help. And it also means hitherto hath the Lord brought us. He said, this is called from this day forward Ebenezer, which means I've made it this far because of the Lord. He's brought me to this point. You know what he was doing? He was setting up a type and foreshadow of what you and I call a testimony. Every time the Lord brings you out of a storm, every time the Lord heals your body, every time the Lord does a miracle for you, he gives you an Ebenezer so that you can say, he's brought me this far. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I don't know what's going to happen next year, but I can testify tonight, the Lord has brought me this far. And when I get another miracle, I can say, he's brought me this far, and he's brought me this far. Everything the Lord is doing for you in the next 40 days is an Ebenezer in your life so that you can look back and say, the Lord has been good to me. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said, from this day forward, musicians, singers, come, because I'm done in 4 minutes. And I can actually stick to that if you come up here and help me and force me to get done in 4 minutes. After 20 years of living without the promise, it all came back to them. And that day, the prophet said, from this day forward, this place will now be known as Ebenezer. The Lord has brought us this far. It's very important. It's very important that it got a name change, because I am sure that it used to have some other name. I'm from Chicago. Everything has a name. That's Tony's parking lot. That's Al's alley. That's Frankie's parking. Everything has a name. Everything has a name. Everything has a name. That battlefield had a name. Had, H-A-D. It had a name. It had a different name until the day the victory came. And when victory came, the name of that place changed forevermore. It's no longer known by what it used to be called, because victory gave it a new name. Isn't it interesting in the church that we have a knack at always identifying people by what they used to be? Blind Bartimaeus, that dude hasn't been blind in over 2,000 years. The prodigal son, that guy was found a long time ago. Well, that whore, Rahab. Hello? I mean, God fixed that one like 6,000 years ago. But we always like to identify people by what they used to be. Well, you see that man? He was a gangbanger. And she, well, I can't tell you in the church, but Facebook me later and I'll tell you about her. We have this knack of always identifying people by what they used to be. But Ebenezer, we don't know what it used to be called. We know that it was a place of defeat, but the old name was lost when the new name came. And I'm prophesying over you today. Those of you that have suffered major trauma in your life, major defeats in your life, you have been known by people by what happened. You've been known by the defeat. You've been known by an old name. But in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, God is giving you a new name from this day forward. You are an Ebenezer in the kingdom of God. And in heaven's book, you're not known by what you used to be. You're known by what you are from this day forward. And I speak victory over you in the name of Jesus. I speak the favor of God over you in the name of Jesus. Come on, stand with me tonight. He is the God of the miraculous, yesterday, today, and forevermore. And I want you to praise him with an Ebenezer praise. I want you to praise him because he's brought you this far. He's brought you this far. He's brought you this far. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. 40 days of the miraculous, 40 days of signs and wonders, 40 days of the unbelievable, the outrageous. He wants to do the outrageous. Why? Because he loves us. Number two, to prove that he's God. The outrage, now, you know, according to his will, he wants to do the outrageous. Sister Heidi made a list. I have a list. I'm moving to Washington, D.C. in about 3 weeks. I don't have a house yet. Well, how are you moving? I have a list. Lord, I got 3 kids, a wife, and I got a moving truck ready to go. All I need is the house. You're going to move that way? Yeah. Why? Because he's the God of the outrageous. He's the God of the miraculous. He's the God that wants to blow your mind so that from this day forward, you'll never take the credit for another good thing that happens to you. Well, it's because I graduated from Pepperdine University. No. If that could do it, we wouldn't have all the problems in this. He wants you to get to the point where you say, had it not been for the Lord that was on my side. It's the miraculous. You know, I grew up in the Midwest, and in the Midwest, and forgive me for just being blunt, transparent today, I feel comfortable in this church, so I'm just going to tell it like it is. In the Midwest, there was a lot of quenching of the gifts of the Spirit for a little while because people took it too far and they abused it, and people got nervous with the gifts of the Spirit and with prophecy and thus saith the Lord, and they got nervous, so they quenched it, and you know,
you can't quench. How is it's incredible that we're Pentecostals and we believe that God can miraculously take somebody's tongue and make it speak in another language, but we don't believe that he can still move in signs, miracles, and wonders. That I'll never understand that. Thankfully, that's not the culture of this house. But I don't want to live in a culture where we always talk about what God did. Where did Jesus, when he ministered in the New Testament, where did Jesus ever sit down and just give expository sermons about what God did? He never talked about what God did. Every now and then he'd say, well, God did. But that wasn't his ministry. His ministry was relational, and his ministry was a now ministry. It was a now ministry. The God that I serve wants to give you a now miracle. He wants to do it for you now. He wants you to go home. I just feel for parents that don't have their children serving the Lord, I feel a strong anointing of the Lord in this house. Parents that don't have their children serving the Lord, I feel a strong anointing of the Lord. It might not be all of you, but some of you are going to have a miracle with your children this week. The Lord's going to give you a miracle this week with your children. One of you has a child that's lost in a gang called the Latin Kings. And the Lord is going to save your child out of that gang, and he's going to bring him back to the King of Kings. I prophesied in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, Israel praised in a place where nobody would praise the Lord. Tonight, if you'll praise the Lord, we're almost out of here. If you can praise the Lord in the midst of whatever you're going through, the same thing that happened to Israel could happen to you tonight. I don't take it lightly that Pastor Rodney would trust me with his pulpit while he's out of town and with the bishop being out of town. I don't take that lightly at all. And let me tell you, from a pastor's heart, you don't bring in guests when you're out. That's just, you know, it's kind of shaky. I could come in here and preach about Twinkies and, you know, they really trust Pastor Gary, and they really trust me in this pulpit. I would never abuse the confidence of the man of God in this house. If the Lord moves on you to give a miracle offering, it's not for me. So get that out of your mind right away. But if the Lord challenges you to give a miracle offering, you ought to go ahead and just do it. Make it payable to the church, however it is that you do it this week. That's not the only business that's going to be blessed this week, says the Lord. Someone else's business is about to get blessed. Somebody that has a business is going to get an offer to get bought out, and it's going to be a good offer because the Lord's going to double your money in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I prophesy it to you. The Lord is going to bless this week. Now, as you're coming forward, don't come yet. Arthritis in the fingers, especially in your index and middle finger. Arthritis in the fingers. If you're here, would you come forward? The Lord would heal you tonight. I felt it while I was worshiping the Lord. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Now, somebody brought up hips. And I don't know who this is for, but there is someone who needs healing. It might not have been the person that mentioned it, but healing specifically in your right hip. Would you come? The Lord would heal you today. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. Let's play something. Let's enter into the presence of the Lord. We are here to worship you, the same song you guys did earlier. We are here to worship you.
Worship in spirit and truth. Let us.
One more time, we are here to worship.
We are here to worship.
Acid reflux, come quickly. The Lord would heal you of acid reflux tonight.
In spirit and truth, let our hearts be in tune.
Hold on. If you have gout specifically in your legs, gout in your ankles, in your legs, would you come right now? The Lord would heal you. Stomach ulcers, would you come quickly? The Lord would heal you tonight. Come quickly. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Gout, where's gout? In the name of Jesus. Gout, in the name of Jesus, be healed. Hallelujah. Thank you. Ulcers. If that's private and you're not supposed to tell, I don't know. I don't really know what it is, so forgive me. Hallelujah. 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 Sir with the glasses back there that we prayed for Sunday, whose name I can't remember. Brother Willie, walk up here real quick. Brother Willie, how you feeling tonight? What's that? Still some pain, huh? You believe the Lord will keep touching you, though. What happened to you Sunday? Has that ever happened to you before? That's never happened to you before. You believe the Lord touched you? There's a difference between the working of miracles and the gift of healing. Miracles are instant. Healing is progressive. I believe the Lord's doing a progressive work inside of your body. Now, we already prayed for the pain. Brother Gary, would you stand behind him? Raise your hands, Brother Willie, and look on me. Look on me, Brother Willie. The eyes are the window to the soul. Repeat after me. Say, nervousness, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Tonight, I will sleep and I will wake up rested. I will not toss and turn. My mind will actually sleep. I will have peace because my God is the Prince of Peace. Brother Wiley, put your hands on his head in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Peace upon you now in the name of the Lord. La paz de Cristo sobre ti en el nombre de Jesús. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Now, Willie, look on me again. I feel from the Lord to pray for your eyesight, and I was about to pray for your eyes, but the Lord said it's not his physical eyes, it's his spiritual eyes I want to heal tonight. You need a new outlook on life, sir. You need a new outlook. Look on me. Life, it's not over. It's not over. Yesterday was not the best day. There's a better day coming. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I pray healing upon your eyes today. I declare the mind of Christ upon you and a new vision for the goodness of the Lord in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. This is going to sound crazy, but since it's the week of the outrageous, is there someone here that has a problem with sweating? Like you don't sweat enough, or maybe you sweat too much, or is there? I mean, that sounds crazy, I know, but is there someone here that needs some heal? All right, well, go ahead. I mean, I've never in my life ever called that out. You might as well come up here before they think I'm faking it. Oh, my God, I've never said that before in my life. Thank you. Thank you. Well, here's someone else coming. My God, maybe I start calling that out at other churches. My Lord. There is a twofer tonight. Look at that. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You know, there's miracles when you worship God, and there's miracles when you obey the word of the Lord. Some years ago, Freddie Clark was with us in service, and we had all kinds of miracles. We had cataracts falling out of people's eyes. I mean, just visible signs of the Lord. And he walked to the back row, and he picked a lady out of the crowd, some visitor. I'd never seen her in church before. And he stood her up, and he said, "You have a tumor." And she said, "Yeah." He said, "You have a tumor in your left breast." She said, "Yeah." He said, "The Lord is going to heal you tonight." She said, "Okay." He said, "Would you know if the tumor disappeared?" She said, "Absolutely." She was wearing a jacket. She said, "Yes, I would know." He said, "You would know if it disappeared." She said, "Yes." He said, "Then I want you to walk to the bathroom of the church. And when you get to the bathroom, check yourself. The tumor will have disappeared." And she put her hand in her jacket, and she said, now she got a little feisty. She said, "I don't have to go to the bathroom. It's still there." He said, "Go to the bathroom." She said, "I don't have to. It's still here." He said, "Woman, go to the bathroom and check yourself." I'm getting nervous. I'm getting ready to call the lawyer, and oh Lord, we're gonna get a lawsuit, defamation of something. And she said, and she just huffs up to the bathroom, and he kept ministering for people. When she walked back into the sanctuary, she came stumbling in, holding onto the wall. And he said, "What's wrong?" She goes, "It's gone." Because sometimes the miraculous is in obeying the directions of the Lord. So I don't know what the Lord will have you do tonight, but whatever it is, do it. Because when you obey the Lord, he moves on your behalf. Now, I already have these that need a miracle. There's a few people here. And if you don't want to come, that's fine. I understand things are private. But there's some people that are contemplating a new business. If you would come, I want to pray for you tonight. New business. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, amen. Before I came to California, my wife and I said, we're going to pray. And we said, God, if you want us to move to Washington, D.C., you need to speak up. You need to speak loud. She just did it. And you need to speak clearly whether we're to go forward or stay where we are. Thus saith the Lord, I'm going to D.C. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hira bahasha tala la mondia sai bai. Hira la bahaseya la la boshanda la mahai. Ikara la boshanda la mahai. Hallelujah. 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 If you've never experienced the power of God, the miraculous, and you're curious, nothing wrong with being curious. You're curious tonight, whether it's fake, emotion, or real. And you would like to see if the Lord would touch you, move on you, do anything in you, if you felt anything. You don't have to come yet. When I begin to pray, you make your way forward, and we're going to pray for you as well. Jesus' name. Yes, sir.
I go there when he went blind 5 years ago, he had a business with special bicycle parts. And he's been trying to, he's trying to get his whole life back together. He wants to feel like a man again. And he says, but he can't get nobody to help him finance a shop. And I didn't, when I left, there's something, I don't know why, I had a burden for him. You know, and I didn't know until right now. I'm going to stand in his place because when I left there, I told two of the people who are head of the blind center. I said, I don't know what happened in there, but I'm going to tell you two and don't tell nobody. But God's going to do a miracle for that man who was totally blind to continue his business. And I didn't know until right now, God said, I'm going to stand for him. And God's going to give him the finances for his business. But it's going to be a testimony unto him. Okay? And the other thing, he told me before Sister Reach told you, not only are you going to move to Washington, but he says, you tell him exactly the house that you want, and it is yours.
I really feel this in the Holy Ghost. Can we just all stretch our hands out to Brother Suarez right now? Because I believe that we're going to send this man. Not only are we going to ask for blessings and prayer and whatever it is in your heart, but we are going to send this man, his wife, his children, because he's a part of us and we're a part of him. We not might not be called to Washington like he is, but we can send them. Whatever that means in your heart, finances, prayer, fasting, everybody, extend your hand to the man of God right now. Dad, Sister Mills, get the oil. Get the oil. Get the oil.
Thank you.
I came to pray for you. I didn't expect you to pray for me. Wow. You know, Nebuchadnezzar never converted to Judaism, but he did respect the God of Israel. And the Lord told me, he said, I'll raise up Daniels in the land, and I'll position them in the society of Babylon as influencers. This world is so divided. The spirit of Absalom is alive and well in D.C. I get criticized because I meet with Democrats, I meet with Republicans. Well, how can you ever influence people that you don't meet with? The Lord said, go to D.C. and start a church and call it the center. And plant it in the center of the center. And when people ask, the center of what? It's the center of whatever they need, because Jesus is the center. And so, you can't ever really get away from your roots. I was telling an Assemblies of God woman last week. I said, I think the Lord has called us to D.C. because I've been using this I think language. The lady told me, go for it. I've been saying, I think he's sending us. I mean, unless he tells us something different, but I think that's where we're going. I said, and if we start a church, we're going to call it the center. And she goes, ooh, Pastor Tony, I don't know if this is going to mean anything to you, but she said, it's not just the center. She says, thus saith the Lord, this is an apostolic center. She said, do you even understand what that word is? She said, I don't know what that means. She said, but this is an apostolic center. She said, you think it's just a center, but the Lord says it's an apostolic center. Jesus, send apostolic revival to Washington, D.C. Send apostolic revival to the Capitol. I don't care if they're donkeys or elephants. Lord, baptize them in the Holy Ghost. Thank you for praying for me tonight. I don't know what to say. I'm trying. The Bible says that the spirit of the prophet is subject to the prophet, and I want to be on the floor right now, bawling my eyes out, crying, and doing a lot of other stuff. And I'm trying to, because we got to pray. If you need a miracle, would you raise your hand? The people I called out, the businesses that we talked about, those that want to experience the power of God. Now, if you don't need a miracle, but you just want to get lost in his presence, the glory of God is in this altar. I know you normally dismiss, and I respect you. I respect anybody that comes to church midweek, because I know it's a tiring day. I know you got, vacation, Bible school, and daycare, and school, and work, and all that stuff during the week. Thank you for coming to the house of God, but there is a mighty presence of the Lord in this place, a lingering presence of the Lord. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I speak healing over those that have come forward in their hips, their joints, their legs, their stomach, their sweat glands. I speak healing in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ right now. Gout, I rebuke you in Jesus' name. Arthritis, come out of their fingers in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody with arthritis, just start moving your fingers. I think they're going to start cracking, and you're going to just start feeling them loose up right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Those of you contemplating starting businesses, I bless you in the name of Jesus. If you'll put God first in all of your things, and you'll be a Matthew 6:33 person, God will bless your business. God will bless your company. He will give you the employees. He will give you the building you need in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I bless you with the blessing of Abraham. I bless you with a long-lasting eternal blessing now in the name of Jesus. Raise your voice. Reshoto romo conde sire manderebo saitai elebo. He reshonde bakeserebo. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth,
fire upon your life now in Jesus' name. Oh, say, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. We are here to worship you. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I bless you in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. I bless you and speak healing, and I speak blessing on you in the name of the Lord Jesus of Nazareth. I speak the favor of God upon you tonight in the name of Jesus. Crown her head with the joy of the Lord and the favor of God. I bless you. I bless you in the person you're standing in the gap for. In the name, oh, shema se boko reme. Shemo sarenda se. Woo!
Worship in spirit and truth.
That's it. Keep worshiping the Lord. Hallelujah. If you're not in the altar already, but you want to receive what the Father has here, would you just come forward? Just step into the presence of God. Oh,
we are here.
We are here
to worship you. Worship in spirit and truth.
Let our hearts. Come on, crank the music for your worthy.
We exalt
yes.
Thee.
We extol Thee.
Extol Thee.
Hallelujah.
Extol Thee for your holy. And we praise you.
A daughter named Michael. Any Michael I know is a daughter of promise, is a daughter of royalty. I bless you in the name of Jesus. I bless you tonight, and I declare you have a promise over your life. You have a purpose over your life. I declare that you are the head and not the tail. I declare that you are part of a royal family. You were dedicated into the service of the King, and tonight I just bless you tonight, and I encourage you tonight, and I remind you that there's a prophecy over your life, and it will come to pass. So I bless you, I encourage you, and I pray the anointing of God upon you tonight in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Oh, we exalt you. Hallelujah.
We exalt thee.
Oh,
joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord. You know why God's doing this? He's doing it because He loves you. He loves you. He favors you. We have a great God. By the power of His love, receive your miracle now in the name of Jesus. Because He loves you, receive your healing now in the name of Jesus. Your peace, your comfort, your joy, your restoration. Just receive it now. Accept the fact that He loves you and that He favors you and that He wants to be good to you. Just receive it now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, we love you, Jesus. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. You're worthy to be praised. You're worthy to be praised. Hallelujah to the King of Kings. We love you, Lord. We praise your name. Oh, hallelujah. If the Lord has already given you, if you believe, sense, feel that the Lord has already touched you tonight, if there's been any improvement, even 60% improvement, if you can tell that there's been some, if you came for a miracle, you can already tell that there's been some kind of improvement, would you raise your hand? Thank you, thank you. Anyone else? Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Hermano, you said there's been an improvement? Is it something you could talk about? Your stomach. There's a difference. There's a change. Okay? Anyone else? Something that you can tell? If it's private, I completely understand. Someone else. Why are we testifying? Because we're establishing Ebenezers. We're establishing Ebenezers for others that don't know. Someone else? You can feel that there's been some kind of improvement? Brother? You're an Ebenezer in the name of Jesus. Amen. Someone else? Someone else? Someone else? Brother Gary, lay hands on her. Not yet. Woman in the purple sweater standing right in front of me. I don't even know if you know I'm here, but the fire of God is all over you. Whoever called you a disappointment lied to you. You're not a disappointment. You're made in the perfect image of God. He loves you. He's never been disappointed in you. He's never stopped loving you. There is nothing that you have ever done that has ever made God love you less. When Brother Gary puts hands on your head, you're going to feel the fire flow through your body. You're going to get your joy back. You're going to get your enthusiasm back. The roller coaster ride is ending, thus saith the Lord. Brother Gary, put hands on her head now. In the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, for you worthy. In the name of Jesus, God is putting His spotlight on East Valley Pentecostal. Significant things will happen in this community, and the spotlight is going to come on this church, and the glory of this house is going to be revealed in this city. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I praise you, I worship you, God, for what you're doing in this place. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Brother Gary, come on up, take the microphone.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, yes! Who's the lady that's wanting to write the book? I just heard the author. Who's wanting to write a book? Who is it? You? Now, you, and then there's a lady. You don't leave. You're part of it. Anytime you're in the right place at the right time, you get stuff that you didn't even ask for. So you stay, but it's a lady. Where are you? Come up here. You get it too, just because you were here. Sometimes it's just good to be in the right place. Now, you did a lot of praying for me, and you've been real bold with me. So I might as well go be bold with you too. Writer's block, go away in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Give her the words. It's already in her mind. Now, Lord, put it on paper and let it just begin to flow. And don't let it take 2 years. Just let it be in a few months that it just all starts flowing. The chapters come together. And, Lord, not only that, but bless her. And Lord, just let the right person pick up the book at the right time. And even though she self-publishes the first time, let the right person pick up the self-published book and say, I'm taking it to a publisher that's going to publish it for her in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I'm just going to be myself. There is fire in your hands. And when you write the book, there will be fire in the pages. And those that read the book are going to have fire that comes upon their life. It is a purifying, cleansing, healing, restoring book that the Lord has put in your hands. You introduced me Sunday. The fire, you introduced me Sunday, and you talked about fire. And I didn't know what he was getting at, and I was really embarrassed that he even brought that up, but I feel fire in this. Ever since he said it, there's been fire all over the place. Now you, sir, you, put your hands up. Lift your head. Look at me, Derek. A few months ago, I was invited to the White House. Well, last year this time. Been back a few times since, but the first time I went to the White House, I felt really weird. Between you and me, hopefully they're not listening. The day I went to the White House, I had less than $4 in my checking account. And I was at the White House. I parked my car at a parking meter and was scared that they were going to tow my car because I had less than $4. And I'm at the White House. Now, I got Hugo Boss on, but I got $4. Hugo Boss was a PM blessing. Pre-marriage blessing. Anyways, well, I look good, but I don't have what I look like, okay? And I walked into the White House. I didn't even have enough money. What do you do with $4? I paid $2 for the parking meter. I had $2 left, and I need to buy lunch. I was walking into the White House. I'm embarrassed. I know I don't deserve to be there. And I go, and I walk into the West Wing, into the Roosevelt Conference Room next to the Oval Office, and I'm about to walk into the West Wing. And as I'm walking towards the door, I'm walking with my head down. I mean, I don't deserve to be here. And I heard the Lord say, pick your head up. Pick your head up. You walk in there like my son. You walk in there with dominion and you walk in there with authority. Pick your head up. And as I was walking towards the door, you know, there's Marines at the doors of the White House. As I'm walking towards the door, a soldier never looked at me, but he just opened doors. And I walked through one door, and another Marine opened another door, and I walked through another door. And the Lord said, that's how it is. He said, I just let you see what it's like in the heavenly. As you walk with your head lifted high, as my son, I will send angels that will open doors for you that no man can shut. And you're to walk through the door. And you're to walk through the door. And he said, don't look down. Keep your head high. Brother Derek. Sister Heidi, would you just, like, brush his shoulders?
She's brushing insecurity off of you right now. Just get it all off of him, all off of him. Yeah, just, there. Yeah. Now, look at me, Brother Derek. Stop closing your eyes when you look at people and stop looking away. You have a right to look them in the eye. You have the authority of God inside of you. Your book is going to encourage people that are insecure, that are suicidal, that are depressed, and are thinking about ending it all. But the Lord is going to give you a word of encouragement. Am I right so far? Okay, thank you. He's going to give you a word of encouragement. But you see, you can't write a book that you haven't lived. You can't preach what you don't practice. So if you're going to encourage others, you have to be encouraged. So raise your hands and keep them open. Raise your hands and keep them open, because you can't receive when your hands are fisted and clenched and closed. Now put them up like this so that you can get everything the Father's about to give you. Now put two guys behind them just in case. Two men stand behind them just in case. Father, let it be a whopper of an anointing that comes upon him right now. The joy of the Lord, self-confidence, boldness come upon him in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. More, Lord, more, Lord, more, Lord, touch. Derek, do you have children? You don't have children yet? Are you married yet? You will be married. You will have children, and you're going to be a good father. You're going to be a good father. Listen to me. You're going to be a good father. You're going to be the father that you've always wanted. You're going to be a good father because you're going to learn from him. He's going to show you that he's loved you irregardless, without any exception. And you're going to be a good father. You're going to talk about the love of God. God is going to bless your children. There's a destiny over your family. And just like there's some families that have generational curses, you, sir, have a generational blessing over your family. Fire upon you in the name of Jesus. Sometimes you got to leave them on the ground so that God can do surgery. Catch him when he goes down. Fire upon you. Now let him go. Let him go. Let him go. Let the Lord do surgery on him as he lays there. You know, that doesn't bug me. Just leave them on the ground. You know, they used to call us holy rollers. You can't roll when you're standing, so just leave them on. Sometimes the Lord's got to lay you out so that he can come down and do surgery on the inside of you, and he'll pick you up and make you whole on the way up. You don't have to believe it. You don't have to like it. You can say this is radical, but I serve a radical, miracle-working God who does outrageous stuff. Outrageous stuff. We prayed for the authors. Oh, they're getting ready to do shouting music. What is what you might? I mean, it's open mic night. What would you like?
I have to testify. About a year ago, I started getting really bad swelling in my ankles, and the top of my arches of my feet were hurt really bad. And so, I told the girls, "This is it. I can't wear heels anymore because it just kills me in my feet. I mean, I have to take pills to sleep at night just because the feet hurt so bad." And so I said, "Okay." And so when this revival started, I came with my heels, and I said, "Okay, Lord, you're going to have to do something because I've come here for you, and I want to look my best, and I ain't coming up here with no flats on." So I said, "Okay, Lord," because my bishop, I'm going to be honest, my bishop said, "Oh, I like it when you girls are in them heels, and it looks nice up there." So I'm going to be okay, Lord. I'm going to do it. So the first night I wore my heels, went home a little sore. Next night I wore my heels. I was okay up here, no pain. I went home a little sore. I want to tell you, I have been in these hills all night, and I have had no pain. And I want to thank God and give him all the glory, because it's the little things that he cares about.
Don't leave. He's the God of the outrageous. There's some hidden, forgotten treasures in your house. I'm not talking about like spiritually, like ooh, talking. I'm talking about some lost money, some lost jewels, some lost stuff in the house. You're going to find it in the name of Jesus. Does that mean something? What does it mean?
My grandfather used to hide money in the house. Yeah, in coffee cans. And when he passed away. Nobody could find it. And I had a dream that I went to the back of the house, and he used to have a little, like a little drain. And I went to the back of that house, and I started digging in that drain for some reason, and I pulled out this bag. And in that bag were jewels. And I was like, what?
Have we ever hung out? No. Have we ever shared a hamburger? Do we Facebook, talk to each other, tweet? You never retweet me. That's something I wanted to bring up. I'm a little hurt about that. But anyways, that's a whole other thing. But you never, you didn't tell me that. You didn't tell me that. He doesn't retweet me either. And so you haven't told anybody. You never told anybody. Now the whole church is going to want to come dig at your house now. They all want to know when the barbecue is. When is the carne asada? I hope it's Friday, so I'm still here. I'm coming with my shovel. I'll be under the table digging. Lord, bless her. Let her find what's lost in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Yes, sir.
Wasn't given a chance to live, period. But I'll tell you what, God has such a touch on me, and as of tomorrow, I've been on this earth 32 years, and I wasn't supposed to live one day from the time I was born. And I don't know why God put that in my mind to say, maybe because we're talking about the God of miraculous or what have you, but.
Cameraman, where's the cameraman? Where's the mobile cameraman? Get close. Where are you? I don't know where you are. Zoom in on the picture. Zoom in. Oh, Lord, I keep looking. Can you zoom in on the picture? Oh, that's as far as it goes. Do you see that? That's my daughter, 7 years ago. I've preached about her. I don't know if you remember. Born 2 months premature. I thought the picture was lost. My 4-year-old son found it while we were packing to move. You see that hole in her chest? It's because the bones in her chest didn't form when she was born. We'll put it on the screen tomorrow at the Spanish service. I hope you speak Spanish. Come tomorrow. Well, take it to the camera. Go show them that picture. If my wife texts me, tell her I'll text her back, all right? Put it up there. I hope you guys weren't in a hurry tonight. All right, just get closer, get closer, get closer, get closer. You see that? That's not that dimple in her chest. Leave her right there. That's not a dimple. She had no bones in her chest. She weighed 3 pounds. Her name's Michael. They said she wouldn't live. Her lungs were underdeveloped. They collapsed when she was born. And they told me, Mr. Suarez, be realistic. She's going to die. She just had her 7th birthday. She's just like you. She's healthy. She's blessed. I speak life. I just speak life in the name of Jesus. Whoever feels like they're about to die, whoever feels like they're underdeveloped, that's the word right there. That's the word right there. There's some people feeling like they're underdeveloped, like they're not qualified, like they just, you know what? What God does in the natural, he can also do for you intellectually, and he can do it spiritually. In fact, I even heard the Lord say right now, there's somebody that is called to the ministry, and they're really struggling because they say, I'm underdeveloped. I just don't know who you are. But in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, the Lord just gives you a miracle development right now in the ministry, intelligence right now in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. He does a work in your life now in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Brother Gary, I'm going to give you the mic because I think I'm done. And I don't think God's done, but I think I'm done. So I'm going to give you the mic, and we'll just, you know, this way if it goes longer, they blame you and not me.
Nobody here is going to blame you. I just want to say that we are here in the presence of the Lord tonight. Brother Tony, I want to let you know something. You're not in the Midwest right now. And we believe in a God that does the miraculous. And we see him. And there's a story in the Bible. You can go home and read it for yourself. But they opened up the roof of the house, and they lowered a friend there. And the end of that story were these words: we have seen strange things tonight. I want to just say right now, if you have not received your miracle, we're not going to shut the lights off here. If you need to go, you can go. But if you still need your miracle, we're going to stay here with you tonight till you get your miracle, because I believe, like this man believes, that our God can do what we need him to do. Amen. There's a service tomorrow night as well, and if we're still here when that service starts, we'll just move over to the chapel.
you have to go. The Lord bless you, keep you, and we'll see you tomorrow. If you're lingering, you might as well linger. This, I just, the God of the outrageous. There's someone here, it's been a long time since you were able to buy new clothes. I have never called this out. A lot of thrift stores lately, a lot of yard sales. It's been a while since you were able to buy new clothes. Come forward. The Lord is going to bless you tonight in the name of Jesus. Who is it? Just come forward. Don't be embarrassed. I mean, God's here. Well, how long? Months? Years? No, I mean, how long since you bought new clothes? Not from the segunda or the tercera. I mean, when was the last time you went to the mall and bought new clothes? You never go to the mall? You go to Ross. Okay. Who else? It's been a while. How long? At least a good year? Come up. Brother Willie, you might as well get some new clothes. I mean, you might as well come up. I mean, it's... You might as well do it in the name of Jesus. How long? You always put yourself last. Lord, bless these people in the name of Jesus. They're the head and not the tail. Lord, bless them, bless them, bless them in the name of Jesus. You don't walk away. Come here. Again, this is only for those that are lingering. If you have to go, we completely understand. There's no problem. God bless you. You, sir, are very concerned about whether you're going to be able to provide for that beautiful baby. You are very concerned if you're going to be able to do it, and you feel a lot of weight on your shoulders. The on us is really on you. Am I right so far? Just affirm it with a loud yes or a loud no.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. I knew you had a voice. Look at me. No baby is ever an accident, and no baby is ever a surprise in the kingdom of God. Why is that funny?
I don't know. It just seems funny, that's all.
Was this baby expected?
No.
Oh, so what do we call that around here? Not in front of the baby, but what do we call it when the baby's not around?
A surprise.
Oh, yeah, okay. Did you tell me that? You don't retweet me either. I didn't want to bring it up or anything, but put your hands out. Put your hands out. Both your hands out. The God that you serve has all the gold and the silver in his hand. And tonight he puts a heavenly deposit into your hands. I speak a promotion over you in the name of Jesus. I speak a permanent job over you in the name of Jesus, and not minimum wage in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray a permanent job. I pray a job where your boss favors you. I pray a promotion over you, and I pray gold and silver into your hands tonight in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You will be a good father, and you will provide for your children in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Keep worshiping. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Sister Heidi, are you still here? Sister Heidi, would you come lay hands on sis right here? Oh, Lord Jesus, a lot of other people have been called out, but you didn't call her out yet, but she lingered, and so now it's time for her to get her blessing. Father, by the laying on of hands, Lord, I just speak strength into her tonight. I speak rest into her in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank you, Lord, for just a blessing of miracles on for her life now by the laying on of hands in the name of Jesus. Just a loosening inside of her body now in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for this saint that has served you faithfully for so many years. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. If you haven't been called out but you have a need, you might as well ask. He's faithful to those that ask. If you're here and you'd want to ask, would you come? And again, if you have to go, completely understand. No problem. Yes, ma'am. It doesn't have to be in the mic. Don't worry. much blessing in your hand that you're just going to be able to hand it out to people. This, when you gave me the oil, the Lord said, I'm just going to put all kinds of stuff in her hand. She's just going to be able to give it to people. You're going to give them joy. You're going to give them blessing. The Lord is blessing you. You're not forgotten. Anyways, I got to focus here. You have this on your wrist. You just got out today. You just got out of the hospital and you came straight to church. A couple hours ago. You stopped, you got tacos somewhere, and then you came to church. Okay, that's good. Would you raise your hands? You're in pain right now. Michael, put your hands on her back. Gently. From the top, and then slowly just bring them down. In the name of Jesus, by the laying on of hands, I command all pain to leave right now in Jesus' name. Be healed right now in the name of Jesus. Do it one more time, Michael. Do it one more time in the name of Jesus. Fire upon you now in the name of the Lord Jesus. Be completely healed now. You and your family be healed now in the name of Jesus. No more lasting effects from the accident. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Who else?